Hi, I'm Ken Mingis. This is Mingis on Tech. And today we're going to be talking about the Eiffel Tower. Well, not the real Eiffel Tower, but the one that Lucas has been printing up with the 3D printer he's been reviewing for Computerworld. Lucas is our 3D printing expert, and I thought this would be a great chance to talk to him about what he's finding out about this particular printer and get an idea for where 3D printing is going now that it seems to have become at least a little bit more mainstream. So, Lucas, this is the orange. In fact, I should mention for people who are listening to the podcast rather than watching us, we've got pieces of a 3-foot-tall Eiffel Tower printed out by a 3D printer in a nice bright orange. So tell me a little bit about this particular project and the MakerBot printer.
Yeah, it's a MakerBot replicator.
Okay.
And they have a new smart extruder. It's called the Smart Extruder Plus that they've come out with. And it's supposed to have solved some of the issues with the original print head or extruder on the 3D printer. And some things such as filament jams, for example. It has a longer feed tube, which is supposed to, a Teflon feed tube, which is supposed to address that. So I've been testing it. I've been printing a lot of things. One of the things it didn't have, it had a very difficult time printing, was my small version of the Eiffel Tower, which is only five inches
high. Like the little white one we've got
down
here.
This one right here.
Yeah.
This was actually done on an STL printer, stereolithography printer, which uses a light-hardened resin to that draws out of a pool. It's very cool to create objects.
So that's not the printer that has a filament that feeds into
it? No, this one's a fused filament printer, but I have printed the Eiffel Tower using fused filament before. This is just the best version of it that I've had.
Right, we should back up for one second.
Sure.
Why the Eiffel Tower? Let's explain why you're doing
Eiffel
this.
The Eiffel Tower has
even
probably...
Even though I know you like France.
I love France. The Eiffel Tower has probably the most detail of any model that you can build, and it's a great test to show how well a 3D printer can replicate small, intricate details, such as the scaffolding that's involved in the Eiffel Tower.
Okay, so this is basically your baseline test.
It's my litmus test for 3D printers. If they can't do it, then I look at how well they did with what they did. So if they produce most of it, but they mess up a little bit on the top of the tower, at the pinnacle of the tower, then yeah, I'll mention that.
Okay, so the MakerBot printer that you're working with right now is what model is that?
The Replicator. It's actually the fifth generation
of it. Okay, yeah. And this is considered one of their high-end printers?
This is their flagship printer. They're consumer 3D printer company to
begin
with.
Ford isn't using this right now to print out
car parts. No, they would use their parent company's printers, Stratasys.
Okay.
They have the big machines that print auto parts, and believe me, they print working auto parts. So.
And obviously that's where the industry is going to go,
I think.
When you've got car makers or designers who are trying to do prototypes, things like that, right?
3D printing is absolutely changing the face of all manufacturing, from airplanes to toys to automobiles to even buildings, because there are now 3D printers that, at least in prototype, that can build buildings.
Well, now explain that to me. All right, so let's say that I'm an architect, and I'm working on some sort of design, and I have designed a building, whatever. How do you get from that to a 3D printed building? You take your design and somehow turn it into CAD drawings? Or, I mean, how do you go from A to B to C?
These are CAD drawings, but there's a standard file type called the stereolithography STL file type that you would save them in. There are other file types, so that's the most mainstream. And you can manipulate those files in CAD software, and that's the great thing about additive manufacturing compared to subtractive manufacturing or mold manufacturing, as was more typical for the industry.
Yeah.
And additive manufacturing, if you mess up a model, all you got to do is tweak the design and reprint it. You're done. You don't have to send it off to another company that has a metal lathe to create the part, and have to pay the cost and wait the time for that to come back, and then check it and see if it works. You can print a plastic one. Let me give you an example. I was out at Ford in Detroit a couple years ago, and they have an entire building designated only for 3D printing.
Okay.
They 3D print, say...
This is for car parts,
for
right?
For car parts, yeah.
Okay.
I'm talking about engine parts. I mean, of course, not pistons or whatnot, although they could do that.
But I'm not sure if I'm ready for my car to be running on a 3D printed engine.
But let's say an air intake, for example. It's typically made out of a plastic or a fiber of some sort.
Yeah.
And they're printing them and then testing them on cars, drive them for thousands of miles, and say, does this part work? Yes. Otherwise, they would have to send it out to a company to be lathed or mold injected.
Yeah.
And that could take days or weeks. They'd get the part back. Whoops, doesn't work. Have to send it back out to the company. I mean, this saves so much time and effort. And think of the creativity. You can have your own designers in there playing with a CAD file, doing whatever modifications they feel like.
Okay, so basically what we're going to be looking at over the next few years is for industries that are doing things like this, auto industry, designers, architecture, building, construction, they'll be able to model the things that they're building very quickly, yep, much more cheaply.
Yes.
And I presume then modify those designs as they go along, depending on whether they want to do it aesthetically or whether it has to do with the actual, you know, the construction itself.
Right.
Let's back up to sure, the MakerBot for a second. So, I mean, obviously we've got a small Eiffel Tower here. You've got the big one here, which you've had to print in pieces. Why the pieces rather than just doing it all at once?
It's still a desktop printer, so it simply can't handle the volume. Right.
How tall will this be when you're done?
This will be 2 feet tall. The only thing remaining is the base, the actual base of the tower,
yeah,
and that's still printing. It comes in two halves, and each half takes 22 hours to print. So this is okay, a slow process.
Is that normal? I mean, do 3D printers, is that one of the things that you get when you're getting a more expensive printer, you get faster speed as an addition to better resolution? Or is speed not the issue, it's more the resolution now?
No, speed's an issue. I mean, with some printers print faster than others, but they're all relatively slow compared okay, to normal manufacturing techniques. I mean, because you're laying down 0.5 to 2 millimeter layers of thermoplastic
yeah,
at a time. So imagine this tower right here, I'm just going to guess, I don't know.
50, 60 hours maybe for
this
you
one? Oh, yeah,
this?
Easily. 5 days. Five days easily.
Okay.
But you're tens of thousands of layers of material on top of each other. I'm printing this at 2 millimeters. So imagine 2 millimeters of thermoplastic melted layer by layer to create a 2 foot tower. So just divide 2 feet by 2 millimeters and you get an idea of how many layers are there.
Yeah. You had mentioned early on when we started talking about the MakerBot that there were a couple of different heads that this yeah, particular printer has. One that's supposed to be better than the other one. I guess it comes standard with one and then you can opt for $200 more for a different
one,
right?
Yeah, it's $200 more unless you order it with the printer, then it's $99. But it's the thing is they're kind of marketing it as a replacement print head because the first thing to wear out on a 3D printer is the print head. That's the thing that has all the most sophisticated electronics and mechanics in
okay,
it. So what they did was they came out with a smart plus extruder, or smart extruder plus, I think it is, and it supposedly is taking care of the problems of faster starts for the printing, fewer filament jams.
Okay.
And yeah.
This is what they promise that it'll do, right?
Yes.
And you're finding that it does?
I'm finding that it has problems.
Oh, okay.
Sadly, right, because I've been dying to test a MakerBot for quite a while, and they sent me a beautiful MakerBot replicator printer,
yeah,
and I put the head on, and it went through the first few jobs just fine. I got to the Eiffel Tower, and it did most of it pretty darn well. You know,
okay,
you can take a look at this. It's pretty intricate. Although it wasn't able to reproduce a 5-inch tall Eiffel Tower. It couldn't do it. The detail was too much for it.
So if you tried to do one like the little white one we've got here and the MakerBot wouldn't do it?
It did it in 2 millimeter, but then when it got to the spire, it turned into a cylindrical shape and it just couldn't reproduce
the
detail.
So it sort of redesigned the Eiffel Tower as it went along and
okay,
not in a good way.
I'm going to get this done any way I can sort of thing, yeah. So, and then I started printing the large Eiffel Tower, and I had a number of filament jams.
Okay. This is with the fancy print
this
head.
This is with the new one, the $200 okay, print head.
So what'd you do?
So I kept restarting. I unloaded the filament, loaded it. It would get done with the base of the platform of a piece.
Yeah.
And then it would jam. And unfortunately, I'd gone home for the night when it jammed, so I'd come back the next morning and it already started. Now, you can monitor this from afar, and I wasn't doing that, but I probably also wouldn't have driven back here to restart it every time. I'd just
right,
be driving back and forth. So that was kind of disappointing. So the solution was actually kind of ironic. I put the original print head back on the printer and it's working just fine printing out the base. So,
okay, good.
You know, maybe I had a one-off print head that just wasn't manufactured correctly or just had a particular problem. I don't know.
Okay. Well, now so MakerBot is obviously one of the name brand 3D printers.
They are, yeah.
Are they like the big cheese? Are they the only ones that are making desktop printers?
Oh,
like
no. There are dozens and dozens of companies make desktop printers. They're one of the larger manufacturers of desktop printers, but they're really focused more on education and probably government, I would think. manufacturer.
Okay, so you're not likely, so this is not the sort of thing where people are buying these, bringing them home and printing up their own toothbrushes or things like
They are, but they're not, that's not their biggest market. That's one of their smaller markets. The consumer market is small for MakerBot. And I'm not sure why, because maybe the price, because these printers go for about $3,000. The one I'm reviewing right now goes for about $3,000, including the head.
$3,000, and that gives you the head. Does it also come with the material you need to use to
print? No, you have to buy that separately, or you can buy
a package.
It's
like buying ink for a printer.
Yeah.
They get you with the printer, then you're on the hook for the ink.
The good thing about MakerBot and some other print companies, 3D print companies, is that you get the filament in spools. And the nice thing about having a spool is that you can always rewind the spool. Or you can buy somebody else's filament to use. That you don't have to. There are other companies, XYZ Printing, for example, that they sell cartridges.
Okay.
And those cartridges have computer chips in them, and you can only use their cartridge in order to print.
They lock you in.
That's like HP. I don't want to be locked into an ink or, in this case, a filament. So that's kind of a nice thing about this.
Okay. One thing I also wanted to ask you about before we wrap up on 3D printing, I know you're working on a story about a 3D printer from Mattel.
Yes.
Mattel, you may remember from the 60s, maybe they still make toys, but in the 60s they had things like the Incredible Edibles and Creepy Crawlies.
Creepy Crawlies.
Look it up. There's a Wikipedia entry for both. I've already checked. So if you don't understand what that means, go look it up on Wikipedia. Tell me what Mattel is doing. Is this a 3D printer for kids?
It is. For families, they say. But there's a couple of interesting things about this. So it's the ThingMaker 3D printer. The ThingMaker was the machine from the 1960s,
right, exactly.
Remember?
So they brought it back.
We're old enough to remember that, aren't we?
Speak for yourself. Speak for yourself. Anyway.
Oh, man, I remember that. Yeah.
So I had an Incredible Edible thing. It was the one where you printed out things you baked things, like this goopy stuff,
you could then eat it. That's basically
what
the
God
same thing.
God knows what's in it.
You could, the ThingMaker didn't make the edible stuff. It made
the little toys, the little plasticky, rubbery
creepy
toys.
Crawlies. So you could make like worms, and you could make
spiders
and stuff like that. And basically, it was a mold, and you poured the plastic into it. Was probably toxic and everything else.
Yeah.
And then you bake the sucker at 300 degrees.
In your bedroom?
It was like what was the baking?
Easy Bake Oven.
Easy Bake Oven.
It's Easy Bake Oven
burned
for
down
boys.
The house,
yeah.
You know?
Okay. Sorry.
But so this is basically that reinvented as a 3D printer, and they have their own app where you download the models various dolls or tin soldier or soldiers or whatever else you want to print. And you just upload it. It's a very inexpensive 3D printer, and it's so cool. It's $300.
Okay, and well ahead of the holiday shopping season. So I presume.
Well ahead. Well, it's not going to be available till next fall, but they're taking pre-orders now.
Fall of 2016?
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
So ahead of this. That's great, ahead of the holiday schedule.
Yeah.
Good, okay. Well, that's a look at 3D printing at the moment between the Eiffel Tower and the, what's it called again, the one from Mattel?
Oh, the ThingMaker.
Yeah. The ThingMaker. I think we've kind of covered the gamut here. Thanks, Lucas, for stopping by.
Sure.
That's a wrap.